Good evening, my friends. Welcome to Channel 48. How are you doing? Well, I need to run Windows 7 on my GNU Linux machine, but I don't want to install it. So, in fact, I want to make a review of how to create a Windows XP Lite CD installation CD. And I want to do it, of course, under Windows. I cannot do it under GNU. At least, I don't know how. So I want to install Windows 7 to this USB stick. It's a 32 gigabytes USB stick from SanDisk. It's a very good stick. Voor mijn Dutch people, deze kun je kopen bij de Action voor 9,95. Echt een goede stick van SanDisk. And how to do a thing like that? Well, there are some guys that created a tool called Win2USB. And in fact, I already created a stick, but I'm gonna show you really fast how it works so I can get started with the actual video. Here we are with my Windows computer, okay? And it was still showing Rufus from the previous video. The bootable USB that we created. Maybe I want to create, let's create a new stick. I'm gonna put in the USB stick and I'm gonna format it. Let's go to my computer. You see, Win2USB. I'm gonna format it. Format. Yes. And I'm gonna grab my official Windows 7 CD. I have a license for that as well. I cannot show you that one, unfortunately, my friends. Huh? You know I love you, but cannot do that. Huh? That is personal. Otherwise, Microsoft will kill me. They will say you are a bad YouTuber. So I don't do these kinds of things. Okay. Probably there are people doing these things, but their name is not Channel 48. Okay, I'm gonna put in the CD. Put it in. Okay, I'm gonna just let it load. No worries with it. And it's by Hasleo. Win2USB, that's how it's called. It's gonna open with administrator rights. Alrighty. Checking for USB, a new version is available. Okay, that's very nice, but I'm cool with this version. Here, I'm gonna select CD-ROM drive. You see that? This tab, the mid tab. And I'm gonna go here on top and select the CD-ROM. You see that? And it's gonna load the CD-ROM. So now I can choose what I want to install. I have a home premium license. Okay, so I'm gonna go for that one, okay? Otherwise, yeah, I will not be able to activate it. And please, destination disk will be the Ultra USB. Now it's asking me MBR for BIOS, GPT for UEFI, MBR for BIOS and UEFI. I'm gonna go for this one, okay? Because I'm gonna run it on a modern machine. As well, probably, and then it should as well boot. Otherwise, it will only boot on old machines if I'm gonna go for MBR for BIOS. So I'm gonna say yes. And now it's gonna take several minutes, so I will spare you these minutes, okay? This is still a video, we can hit pause. So I'm gonna hit pause, and I'm gonna let it start, but I'm just gonna show you that it's gonna start. In fact, it's still reading. It's reading the CD. And why am I using the CD? Well, because I have a license for this CD. So what should you do if you have no license? Then, yeah, you're gonna have a problem after 30 days. Then after 30 days, you will have to create a new USB stick. You will have to do that every 30 days. Then you can be on a trial forever. But I'm not advising that. Of course, you need a license, even though Windows 7 is not being supported anymore. You know, get a license. Here it's saying it's going to use 14 gigabytes installer mode legacy. So it's going to create a legacy disk. That's really cool. So now we're just going to hit next. We just hit next. It's all good. And now it's going to start. Okay, so I'm just going to now pause the video and get back to you when we're done. And then we're going to boot it on my UEFI device. Well, UEFI device. It's set to legacy. But yeah, so that's what we got to do after this. Now, I must tell you, my friends, that this takes kind of long, okay? This is kind of crazy. It's still busy. I've been doing a whole lot of things in the meanwhile. I'll tell you that this kind of takes a bit, okay, peeps? This might take up to maybe 1 hour. I'm doing this on an old machine, on an E machine, model 530 or so. So this is a very old 1600 megahertz Celeron processor that is doing the work now. Maybe on your computer it will go faster, but I've been busy for a whole while already doing other things, and we're now at 86%. I must say that if you're gonna do it from an ISO, it will go way faster, but then it will create a VHD. And in fact, I don't want the VHD, you know why? Because if I do it this way, then with my GNU machine, I will be able to get into the folders of the Windows. So in fact, I don't have to go on the internet with this Windows. I can just, in my GNU system, download whatever I want and put them in the folders of the Windows immediately. But with the VHD, I cannot do that. You understand? So yeah, we're better off creating this from an official CD. And yeah, that's just how it is. Okay, then you're gonna have a better system. A system that will be accessible like a real system, as if it was installed, you know, on a hard disk. So yeah, just letting you know. There we are. This is my, my Asus. What kind of laptop is this? HP. My HP ProBook. It's running my KLM OS, and we're gonna reboot the computer. Here we're gonna restart. Hitting F9 to boot from SanDisk drive. There it is. And there we go. Starting Windows, my man. Installed on the USB stick. I hear that the sound is found, but that's most of the times the case with these USB speakers. I got these speakers really cheap, 5 euros. They are from Ominex speakers, long time ago. I saw that they were USB speakers. They only have, you know, a cable that is going to a USB plug. Amazing speakers. You can use them in GNU. You can use them on Macs, Hackintosh machines that you know, that you did not find the sound card drivers from. Sometimes it happens. Not all text files are easy to find. sometimes you must modify them and do all sorts of crazy things to get your sound card to work. And then it's handy if you have these speakers, you just plug them in and, you know, they work immediately. So now we're, yeah, now the devices will be checked. That is necessary to know for the operating system what devices are in the system. And the necessary devices are being installed. That's what it's saying. Apparaten worden geïnstalleerd. That means devices are being installed. So I can let you look at the complete thing if you want. You know, I'm not sure if that is exactly what you want. So I'm gonna skip this part a little bit. You have to, you have an idea what is happening. It's at this point checking, you know, all the hardware, so we don't end up with a blue screen of death. And in the meanwhile, I'm gonna get me some food. All right. So we're gonna let this go really nice, and then I'm gonna get back to you when this is done. So, I'm gonna prepare for first use. So, I'm gonna see if the cook did a good job. This looks good. Because I'm happy. When you put a password here, then you cannot bypass it easy. I'm gonna do this later, man. I'm not gonna type the complete thing now. It's not needed. Later. I'm only gonna install important updates such as, you know, tools that we need. In fact, I'm not gonna install any update. There are no updates anymore. The system will be used to do certain Windows things, you know? It's a portable Windows that you can configure on several devices. It will remember all the drivers. See that test modus? That means it needs to be activated. Beeldscherm. Resolution 800x600, 1366x768. That will be a better, yes. See? Everything nice and round. There we go. Windows 7. Let me put some icons on the desktop. Boom. Boom. Okay. Let me put my classic theme like that. me change the performance. Right mouse click my computer settings, and then advanced system settings, and then prestaties set to best. Set to best, how you say that? Prestaties. And I can go install my tools now. Don't we have internet? No. Oh gosh, all the drivers must be installed, of course. Oh, let me see. Not even ethernet, nothing is installed, but I'm smarter than that. I have, let me see where it is. Damn. Don't tell me I put all these things here and it's not here. Oh yeah, there it is. Look, I have a little USB drive that I'm gonna put in here. Ta-dum. This is the RT7500 or so, whatever it is. But it should give me internet. These things are important to have. You know, because when you run into problems like this, no internet, no ethernet. Eh? I mean, like no Wi-Fi and no ethernet drivers found by Windows. The effect, you have a problem. Because then you need another computer to go and get all these drivers, or you should have all these drivers on some stick. Some people do, they have some USB, then you have no problem. Then I didn't say anything. But most of the times that is not the case. Then you must go look and find all sorts of drivers, and then, you know, you are being tricked into installing certain tools that come with spyware. Life of a Windows user is not easy, trust me. So yeah, now even a browser we will not have. So let me connect really fast to my Wi-Fi. Oh, shut up, you. Can't make connection with this network. What kind of blood clot is this? Are you stupid or what? Are you stupid? Hey, there we go. We're connected. I'm home. Okay. Then it's gonna start complaining that I have 30 days left. Yeah, fine. Whatever. Ach, get out. Your nonsense. Okay, so Internet Explorer is of course very outdated. And we're just gonna type here. Ugh, shut up. Next, later. Firefox offline download. What was this? Windows 64-bit? I'm gonna go for anything. English, C, D, E, Dutch, English, 64-bit. Oh, that's Canadian. Let's go for English, US. Save 49 megabytes, yes, continue. Oh, look at that. And that thing was complaining just now. Dang. And there we go. Oh, and now we don't need Explorer ever again. And we're gonna remove. Did you hear that? I said, no, we're not gonna use Explorer ever again. And then a paper fell from the wall. And now we don't need Explorer ever again. Close. And we're gonna remove. Like the paper is saying, yes, I agree. Never ever again. So I'm gonna remove all the Explorer links. Get off this thing here. And I'm gonna remove it here as well. 64-bit. Yes, fantastic 64-bit. Just remove it. Remove all these links. Come on. Remove. Wow. This thing is lagging, man. Yes. Go away. Here's another one. Remove. Yes, please. Thank you. Let's do a custom install because I don't want the maintenance service of these guys. It's annoying. It's demanding. So now I can continue my food again. The chicken is not bad. Love the chicken. So what I'm gonna do, after Firefox is installed, I'm gonna watch a Western film first, and then I'm gonna come back, and then we're gonna finish this. Okie doke, my friends. Because now I want to watch a nice cowboy video, cowboy film. This thing is slow, man. What are you doing, man? Housekeeping. Okay, launch Firefox. Happy I found this Wi-Fi stick again. It's a very old one. I bought this thing for my Hackintosh projects long time ago. Every Mac computer can deal with it. There are drivers for Mac. Yes, 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 nice. So let's go to YouTube. You see YouTube is already in there. Very amazing. So let me see what Western I'm gonna watch today. Huh? You must type. What the crap is this, man? Hey, I was on YouTube. Stop that piece of nonsense of yours. Western. Let me see what I'm gonna watch today. Without Honor, Western Front. Most of them I already saw. Oh, this one I want to see today. Okay, my friends, I'll be back after this video.
My mother is actually.
So there we are. This is my system. In fact, it's very light still. I did not do too much yet. I installed Cool Edit. I still have to install Cubase. I'm gonna install. No, I cannot install Reason probably. Well, I have 17 gigabytes free space. I want to see if I can install my old version of Reason, version 3. I still have 17 gigabytes free space, so it should be possible. Okay, I think it's like 1 or 2 gigabytes, big reason. And the songs, yeah, in fact the plugins sometimes are big, but I'm using a standard set of plugins. So yeah, shouldn't be that of a problem. So that's what I'm gonna do with my system. At the creation, you as well saw that that I selected a CD-ROM and not an ISO file, because the ISO file would let me create a VHD image, and the difference between VHD and the system that we in fact created with the CD-ROM, it's there's a big difference, because as you all know, Windows 7 should not be used on the internet anymore. So the system that I'm building on USB stick is not a system to go on the internet. It's a system that I will utilize the stick, to say it this way, the Windows. It will be utilized, meaning I'm going to have applications on it that I can use forever for the rest of my life, you know, on every computer I'm going to activate it on. You can run the stick on other devices as well, but the activation will only be for one device, okay? Because that's what I found out, because I activated my DVD. And then I stick the stick into another machine, into my Mac, to see if it would boot with refit stick as well, for the helping of the start boot, to say it this way, the pre-bias of Mac from Macs, and it booted fine, okay. But when I got into the desktop, same thing, it went searching for drivers and so, and then it would not be activated, so it will then still have all your applications, but it's gonna treat the device as if it's another device. And if you were activated before, then it will not be activated on that machine. And then you'll be like, hey, my activation is gone, you know? But when you're gonna put the stick again in this machine, for instance, then it's gonna be activated again. So that's kind of good to know. So don't think that you're creating a stick that you can run on any computer and that it will always be activated, because that will not be the case. Maybe if you use some loader or something like that, that probably it will. I'm not sure, you know, but yeah, I'm not using that. I'm using my own, you know, my own serial. I have a key. And sometimes, yeah, when I use that key too often, for instance, if I'm gonna kill the system again and reinstall it, then probably I will have to call with.
Because on behalf of KLM, Royal Dutch Airlines, we wish you a very pleasant flight.
what you just heard was my startup sound. This operating system, I put it together, and it's called KLM OS. You can download it. I have it in my list if you like it. I've been using it since then. That while I created many other distros after that, but this is just it's so stable. I love this operating system very, very much. So that's why I'm still using it. I've been using it for months now, really. So I was telling you about the way of creation from the stick. Here you can see the Windows that we were running just now. I will be able to open it, and I can go into everything. You see that? I can go to users, and then to studio, and to, for instance, downloads. Grab all these downloads, make a backup before I'm gonna kill the beats, you know. Here I have my Komodo internet security, sys, downloads, install, XML, binaries, and then sys. I think I already grabbed them out. I have to unpack that again, I think. Yes, I already took them out and I deleted them, but I still have the original file. So yeah, I can, you know, easily put something in there. So for instance, I'm not going on the internet with that machine, so I want to put something in there. For instance, name it this mix. I want to put it there, boom, and it's been being copied to there. You see that? So that is kind of very handy. I will always be able to still get into the file system, so I can put all the tools that I need in there, and then, you know, just log off and boot into Windows. Make sure, you know, the thing cannot connect to the internet, and you'll be doing your work nice offline, you know. Yeah, especially if you do personal work that you don't want, you know, every server out there to know whatever you're doing, because that is the case with this operating system. No, the moment you're gonna be online, it's gonna tell Papa and Mama everything that you did on the computer, you know. You're being kind of treated like a child, you know. That's not only with Windows, all the operating systems except GNU. GNU is not doing that. They do, but just a little bit, you know. If you're gonna do bad things, they're gonna know. And then suddenly your system will not work anymore. If they don't like the things that you do on GNU, then suddenly your system don't work anymore. That is GNU. So I like that, you know. I love that. And I've been using this for months, getting updates whenever I want. So this is the best operating system in the world. But the Windows 7 is as well a very good operating system to do all sorts of things that I cannot do with GNU. So GNU and Windows, yeah, they should in fact be in one. This is the best way how to still use Windows 7. You know, you install Windows 7 on a partition, you make sure it has everything. Or if you already had Windows 7, you know, you install GNU. On top of that, make sure you have enough space. GNU will, you know, make the boot for you. So it will say, you know, how would you like to start up with Linux or in Windows? And then you can scroll down and select your Windows, boot into your Windows, go do your work, and, you know, reboot back into Ubuntu and go do fun. You see, that's how you keep pleasure and fun separated. It's kind of handy in computer world, you know. So that's it. Beautiful. So I hope you learned something. I hope you like this video. I love this tool. So Hasleo, big up to you. Thank you very much. Yeah, peeps, check out this tool, Hasleo. Start making your USB stick, your installer. Install your Windows on your USB stick. I must tell you that for the Windows 10, you will have to pay a little fee. So if you're gonna buy the program from Hasleo, then then you're gonna support them as well. But then you will as well be able to install Windows 10 to a USB stick. Back to the studio.
I spoke a whole lot and I explained a whole lot. I hope you kind of got it all. So go ahead and try it out. Remember, when you're gonna use the ISO, it will create a VHD. And if you're gonna sometimes use the ISO, it will say could not find boot. So the best to use if you want to create an installer, a portable Windows, please use the DVD, you know, download the ISO, create a DVD, and use that DVD to be written to the USB stick. It will take longer, but you're gonna end up with a system that you can edit from out your GNU system, you know, or maybe your other Windows system that you're using, you know, whatever system you're using, you will be able to get into the drive. It will be open and not some image that will say nothing there. You understand? So good luck with your portable Windows. I'm kind of happy with it. So I'm gonna kill it again. I'm gonna make a backup from all the things that I did last night and see, you know, if I can make an even better system and take precautions, because in Windows, as I already said, Windows users don't have an easy life. They must immediately, you know, start thinking about many things, and Windows users are getting tricked, thinking they are downloading something and then it's a virus and then boom. But Windows is, you know, still trying to protect the user. It will say in the browser, yo, this file is a virus, and if you're gonna still open it, then in fact you are stupid, and I was. So yeah, well, that's it, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for watching. If you like this video, you are free to leave it a thumbs up. If you did not subscribe yet, subscribe, hit notifications if you want to be notified whenever I upload a new video again, and then I say hasta la vista, see my next video again, bye bye.